man sits down and he fingers the guitar and he hits the first note and he brings his head up and he sings, "I'd rather be the devil than to be that woman's man." And it was a gasp. Wow.
You know that I'd rather be the devil. I'd rather be the devil than to be that woman's man.
I thought I was just gonna faint right there at the spot.
Because the way that I love her, you know it's a skeleton of shame.
And boy, he was back. Just an explosion. Who is this guy?
The woman that I love.
It was just amazing to be, you know, a young white college-age kid getting to interact and learn so much from these, what really I would consider old masters.
But you know he done got lucky, he done got a bag again.
These were people who had learned their music and created their music by living it. It was first-person music. It was people singing about their own lives. It was people who had lived very hard lives. I was a comfortable middle-class kid.
And I couldn't take me no risk.
Backstage at the blues festivals that I got to hang out at, rightfully so, it was a big party. And it became known, Dick would tell me, you know, don't let so-and-so have too much. And Sunhouse in particular was very famous. If he didn't have his airplane bottle of vodka, sometimes he couldn't remember his lyrics.
You know I'm so sorry today, little girl, that I ever know your little name.
He had to have some just to jog his memory, but if he had one too many, then he wouldn't be able to remember them.
But when you get lonesome.
They never had any idea what was happening. There was a strange audience of people they hadn't even been allowed to look in their eyes, and suddenly here was this audience, and they had no idea what they were hearing or anything. They just knew that somehow the audience seemed to like it, so they did it.
Imagine the culture shock is that here all your years you've had to take your hat off, step out into the street, you know, be careful of your speech, and the script flips over. You're 67 years old, and here come these kids down, white kids down, they're saying, "Oh my God, your songs, I've got them on, I know all the lyrics to them," and they're just like, you know, they didn't really know what it was.
The meaning of the blues had changed. What had been a black pop phenomenon till the 60s had now been reframed as a music of pain and alienation from the old Delta.
Lord, I'm going down south, baby.
And these old musicians, practically unknown when first recorded, were now performing songs that spoke to this new white vision.
There is a yearning on the part of wealthier, whiter, middle-class audience for something that is primal, to do with the rhythms of life as it used to be known that we've lost in the Industrial Revolution.
The Delta was a vibrant place. I mean, Muddy Waters left for Chicago on the train. By the time the blues hunters turned up in the early 60s, those trains had stopped running a long time ago and the train tracks were grown over with grass. You know, this was a world that seemed like modernity had never come near it. Understandably, it was hard for anybody who went there to imagine that it had ever been any other way.
But for this new generation of fans, one enigmatic country blues artist in particular would come to embody all of the darkness and gothic mystery of the Mississippi Delta.
There were a number of black people, especially ministers, those who were very religious. They thought if you could go to a crossroad where two dirt roads intersect, at midnight.
You can sit there with the two rows going on each side of you and the one behind you at midnight, and you'd play the best you can, and you'd hear somebody coming up behind you playing guitar. Don't look around.
Satan will walk up behind you, tap you on the shoulder, you hand him over the guitar, and once he plays that guitar, you have made a deal with the devil. You have sold your soul to the devil.
And when you get up the next day, you can play anything you want to play on guitar. That was the story I heard when I was a kid.
Early in the morning, when you knocked up on my door.
You stand at a crossroads in the Mississippi Delta at night.
Early in the morning.
And tell me you're not scared.
When you knocked up on my
You stand in the dark. It's an isolated place. There's panthers still in the Mississippi Delta.
And I said, hello, Satan.
Robert Johnson, the bluesman who sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads. This myth grew to fill a void of historical fact. He was the ultimate blues mystery and became the most seductive blues rediscovery of the 60s.
Robert Johnson had always been kind of just this mystery. We knew nothing about him, except we had heard he was dead.
But one blues hunter would make a breakthrough.
People love myths, or they love stories. Johnson's the perfect man. Nothing was known about him.
I got a kind-hearted woman. Anything that's worth for me.
I first started asking about Robert Johnson around 1964, but there was very little information on Johnson. And in 1965, I went to the Department of Vital Statistics in Mississippi to search for a death certificate on Robert Johnson. And this is the death certificate that I received on the 11th day of January, 1968. The man is dead a year after he records in August of 1938 at age 27. But the death certificate caused a lot of controversy because no one knew where he actually died.
Some say he died in a barroom brawl. Others said he was a victim of syphilis. Or maybe he was poisoned and died howling like a dog. Even until recently, the whereabouts of his grave was much disputed.
Here we are at the gravesite of legendary Robert Johnson in Greenwood, Mississippi. This is the place where he took sick and died in 1938. For a long time, people weren't even sure where he was buried. Up until just a few years ago, there were three different places that would tell you that they had the remains of Robert Johnson. But now this has become the official location of the body of Robert Johnson. And I think that the reason why Johnson has become so interesting and so famous to us is because we don't know a lot about him. He's really kind of a phantom.
All this began in 1961 when Robert Johnson, king of the Delta blues singers, was released. While the search for forgotten bluesmen continued, a dead artist virtually unknown in his own lifetime was suddenly being hailed as the greatest blues artist ever.
The record cover, the picture, was the Black Poet. The idea of this lone figure in his own world. He's hunched over his guitar. He isn't looking out at the audience. He's looking into his own soul.
Robert has become that portal figure for a whole white world to enter into the black experience.
If you were someone like the Rolling Stones and you had already heard Muddy Waters, this just sounded like where all of that came from, but with a complexity in the guitar work that you'd never heard, it felt like the roots of everything.
You better come on in my kitchen.
The structure of the songs was so unique. I mean, come on in my kitchen is, you know, these are not everyday blues. I think he raised the bar.
But she's gone. I know she won't come back. I'd take the last nickel out of her nation, sir. You better come on in my kitchen. It's going to be raining out.
There's visuals in that music, you know.
Oh, can't you hear that wind howl?
Yeah, can't you hear that wind howl?
And you can feel it and you can see it. It's just so beautiful.
You better come on in my kitchen. It's going to be raining.
Johnson somehow is crystallized the whole point of it, and like, what could be done. Everybody's still reaching for that bar.
He was the perfect artist when rock came along and you wanted to understand where it came from.
The rediscovery of Delta blues artists like Robert Johnson may have been making waves among the folk festival and coffee house crowds, but the sound of young black America was now Motown, and for mainstream audiences, the blues remained a dead music. So when a group of scruffy London blues fanatics arrived in the land of their idols in 1964, they were confused by what they found. I am the little
red rooster. By the time we got to America, we were well aware that these guys were not in the mainstream of music. We couldn't understand why, especially when we got into American cars and they got 15 channels and there's always a blues channel, a black channel going, playing this stuff. And, you know, Whitey weren't listening, you know? Just didn't go down that end of the dial. Mick and I and the boys would walk in '64 to juke joints down in Mississippi and be considered a novelty, of course. But at the same time, a pleasant novelty, and plied with drinks and all the stuff. If you went into a white club, we'd be treated like black people because of the hair.
I remember driving Brian Jones back to their hotel and people screaming, homo, homo, because he had that shoulder length hair.
Hey, are you guys wearing wigs?
I don't want you to be no slave. As part of their blues pilgrimage, the Rolling Stones recorded at Chess, where they came face to face with their idols.
I'm only 21, I've died and gone to heaven, you know what I mean? Everybody was very supportive, you know, because you feel you're walking right into the lion's den at that age. And to come out with everybody's goodwill was, you know, yeah, okay, now we can talk, you know.
They were drinking hard liquor out of the bottle, like Jack Daniels right out of the bottle, you know. And of course the black artists would pour it in a water glass and sip it. It was a different style.
I know a lot of more about the blues by meeting the people than you ever would just by listening, you know. I mean, I slept at Muddy's house. And I woke up at Howling Wolf's, but that's another story.
When the Stones broke big a year later, America was suddenly all ears.
We just thought more people should hear the blues. And then as we got popular, we found that we were more in a position to do that. We were missionaries in a way.
An invitation to perform on a top teenage TV show called Shindig presented them with an irresistible opportunity.
I was at the 1965 Shindig taping where the Rolling Stones would not be on Shindig unless Howling Wolf could be on. ABC thought it was an animal act. A Howling Wolf? Sure, whatever you want, bring a Howling Wolf.
They had no idea who a Howling Wolf was and probably wished they didn't, because, I mean, these are uptight white cats from L.A., you know, and it's the early 60s.
So I think it's about time you shut up and we had Howling Wolf on stage.
Yeah, how many more years
audience loved Howlin' Wolf, and they were like, he overwhelmed them.
The Stones had managed to smuggle a 54-year-old, 6'3", 21-stone, forgotten Mississippi bluesman onto primetime television. Mainstream America sat up and watched the Wolf smash through a racial barrier.
From that, a lot of guys who felt that their music was sort of being, like, drifted off because of Motown and R&B found a whole new audience.
The British did it and went and told the world who these great people was. And then that's when white America said, let me go see.
The Rolling Stones were the first pop stars to insist that they were playing the blues. With them, a new wave of American white kids picked up electric guitars and started playing blues licks.
I didn't hardly know any white people who was listening to blues music before them English bands come over, and all of a sudden everybody's name was a blues band. All of a sudden it was like Santana Blues Band or Steve Miller Blues Band or Siegel Schwal Blues Band.
But for those who still saw the blues as an acoustic folk art, these electric blues bands were imposters. So when pioneering musicologist Alan Lomax introduced the Paul Butterfield Blues Band at Newport in 1965, these two opposing visions of the blues would collide.
I think amongst the white folk fans, there was definitely the feeling that if you didn't have an acoustic guitar, if you had an electric guitar, you weren't the real thing.
In 1965, we went to Newport. It was the Paul Butterfield Blues Band. Alan Lomax, who was the curator of the workshop, just took great offense at the fact that these guys were plugged in and playing loud.
He didn't like the idea of this group at all. They were electric. Lomax said, you've heard the real thing. You've heard blues musicians from the South play this music. Now we're gonna hear some kids from Chicago with the help of all these amplifiers up here, try and play the blues.
They just tore it up. I mean, they were bad to the bone. And there's me standing on the sidelines, just almost jumping out of my skin with my friends because we were so knocked out by the sound they were putting out.
Albert Grossman, who was managing the Paul Butterfield Band, said, that was a real chicken shit introduction, Alan. And the next thing you know, they're throwing punches.
We look over, and these two big old guys are engaged in fisticuffs and rolling around in the dirt there on the side of the stage. That was an interesting indication of how the old guard decided that they were going to be the people who defined what the blues were.
The blues represented a certain kind of idealized Americana. It represented a kind of communitarian vision. Putting an electric guitar on it was like, you know, sticking a dollar sign in front of it.
He was upset because these people with their decades and centuries honed style of making music and singing, you know, were just kind of being swept aside.
What fascinated Alan always was where the music came from. I don't like the word pure, but I like the word basic, you know, that they were finding all the original forms of the blues. But then I'm not sure he liked what happened to it, because, you know, it did partly become commercialized.
You can understand he's from his era, you know, and he's been honking around all of these penitentiaries looking for the original thing, like looking for fool's gold.
Preserving this vision of an authentic acoustic blues was rapidly becoming an irrelevance. A new generation of white American blues rock fans were rediscovering the electric blues greats. One blues man who had no nostalgia for acoustic guitars in Depression-era Mississippi was B.B. King. His urbane uptown blues instantly struck a chord with this new breed of fan. My head's in misery, my heart's in a
opinion, B.B. King is the greatest blues singer guitar player that ever recorded. And his longevity speaks for that. And he had class and dignity, and that's what black people wanted to see.
You never sort of said B.B. King to see a funky show, or, you know, you see something outrageous. You went to hear very finely honed, beautifully played music.
He just exudes this quality of, like royalty. I think he's raised blues to be something that is full of pride.
While B.B. King's refined brand of blues was filling up auditoriums across the states, the influence of the blues was beginning to underpin new musical directions. As the 60s became the 70s, its licks, attitude, and mythology evolved into the foundations of rock culture. Songs well over three decades old by the likes of Robert Johnson and Skip James were being reimagined as a brand new sound. Blues rock became hard rock. Hard rock became heavy metal. What was left of the blues seemed lost in cliche and excess. But by the dawn of the 80s, a new wave of musicians and audiences began to cast their eyes back past the bloated beast of rock. In doing so, kickstarted another blues revival. The success of new artists like Stevie Ray Vaughan and Robert Cray proved beyond question that the blues was a music with vast commercial potential. Now even yuppies like the blues. I get a strong, uneasy feeling.
You're not sitting there alone. There was a burst of interest in blues in the 80s, especially led by Stevie Ray Vaughan. Stevie was at the forefront of the 80s and early 90s blues revival.
There was a resurgence of the blues and R&B. The music was a little more simple, it was more accessible. I think that the public heard it as something new.
From out of the shadows into this bright new musical landscape emerged a familiar figure with an unfamiliar sound.
It turned a lot of people on to blues that ordinarily would never listen to blues or know anything about it.
Santana went in and cut John Lee Hooker with that healer, and that was a big thing for him. I was so proud of him for that because you couldn't forget him from Boogie Children on, but he was kind of being forgotten.
The healer made 72-year-old John Lee Hooker into a global megastar.
That was great for John. And it was great for blues. Blues are healing all over the world.
Blues are healing, heal hard. He appreciated this success. He dressed nice. People knew him, you know. So as a man coming from, you know, Mississippi and then moving up and being successful in the music business, I mean, that was it. That was as good as it gets, you know.
When I saw the list of who was going to collaborate on that record, I couldn't wait to be part of it. And luckily, I'm In the Mood hadn't been chosen yet, and that was my favorite song of his. I'm in the mood. Oh, no. And he and I just start going together without any rehearsal. It was a moment that will remain a highlight for me. Now, 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 baby. Pride for your love, not bunny. I hear you call. No, not bunny, it ain't not bunny. It felt exactly like it sounds. And it just went on and on. And at the end of it, I literally had to go, I asked for a towel. That's how deep it was.
I want to thank you, baby.
The revival of John Lee Hooker in the early 90s pointed to a wider trend in American culture. The blues was now firmly embedded at the heart of the great American narrative. And big brands were quick to take note.
I think advertisers use the blues because it speaks to rough authenticity, to being genuine, to being unvarnished. These are jeans worn by working people who are out there in the real world, not slick. It's the anti-slick music.
Boom, 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 boom. There was a big campaign going on at that time. It was hip to be blue.
Blues was now being used to sell everything from jeans to beer.
Now, of course, blues is being used in Viagra commercials.
Why would you let something like erectile dysfunction get in your way? Isn't it time you talk to your doctor about Viagra?
I'm very scared that this is the new blues demographic. But if I'm eventually going to need an ED medication, I'm definitely using the one that uses the blues in the commercials.
Seek immediate medical help for an erection lasting more than 4 hours.
In 2012, President Obama hosted an evening of blues at the White House. After 100 years, a music created by a generation of Americans who had nothing was being used as the ultimate emblem of the American dream.
It's a once in a lifetime, and I still slap myself or pinch myself now and say, is that really you? That's a long way from picking cotton on the farm than picking the guitar in the White House. And then he come up and made the speech after we finished playing. He went to walk off the stage. I said, no, Mr. President, I understand you can sing Sweet Home Chicago.
Come on, Mr. President, sing!
Come on! Yeah. Baby, don't you wanna go? Yeah.
Sweet Home Chicago, Robert Johnson's 1936 anthem of black migration from the despair of the South, being sung by the most powerful man in the world. The blues narrative has seemingly reached its symbolic peak.
Sweet Home Chicago.
Yeah! I was overjoyed. I cried after we finished the show because that's a dream come true. You know, I didn't ever think something like that would happen to a blues guy to be up in the White House playing for the President of the United States.
Oh, yeah.
Over the last 100 years, the blues has transcended racial, musical, and national boundaries. Its icons, songs, and stories now form a part of the DNA of a nation.
Way past 21.
And for what remains the poorest region in the country, the blues is beginning to provide a much-needed economic boost.
People of the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s in the South would be amazed that a large part of the tourism economy here in Mississippi is about blues history. To see modern-day South embracing black culture, I think that's a remarkable change.
Whatever you're listening to now, there's not one thing you're listening to that isn't in some way influenced by the blues. That's, I think, why the blues is maybe, and why we're talking about it, is that it's very simple in concept, but to deliver it is another thing.
All over the world, wherever I've traveled, there's people playing blues. Even if they don't understand the words, their heart knows that feeling, and they want more. They got to have more. And that's the beauty of the blues. You can't deny it. It ain't going away.